Want to speak real Spanish from your first lesson? Sign up for your free lifetime account at SpanishPod101.com.
Hi everyone, I'm Rosa, and today we'll be doing 10 phrases to amaze native speakers. So let's begin! El español es divertido y fácil de aprender. Spanish is fun and easy to learn. El español es divertido y fácil de aprender. Spanish is fun and easy to learn. I think the pronunciation is very easy in Spanish. Yeah.
Aparte de saber español, también puedo hablar algunos otros idiomas. Apart from knowing Spanish, I can speak a few other languages as well.
Aparte de saber español, también puedo hablar algunos otros idiomas. Apart from knowing Spanish, I can speak a few other languages as well. Tell me which other languages you can speak. I can speak English, a bit of Japanese and French, but yeah, I have to study more.
Estoy aprendiendo español por mí mismo. I'm learning Spanish all by myself.
Estoy aprendiendo español por mí mismo. I'm learning Spanish all by myself. So good for you. Like, I know it's hard, but if you are, I don't know, if you are constant and you do something every day, I think you can also like learn languages by yourself. Like today there are so many resources on the internet. And...
Hablaré español como un nativo en 3 años.
I'll speak Spanish like a native speaker in 3 years.
Hablaré español como un nativo en 3 años.
I'll speak Spanish like a native speaker in 3 years. Oh, good luck!
He estado aprendiendo español por 10 años.
I've been learning Spanish for 10 years.
He estado aprendiendo español por 10 años.
I've been learning Spanish for 10 years. Yeah, I might have been studying English for longer than that.
Me tomó solo un año para hablar fluidamente.
It took me only 1 year to become fluent.
Me tomó solo un año para hablar fluidamente.
It took me only 1 year to become fluent. Wow. I admire you so much.
Gracias, pero en realidad no soy un hablante nativo.
Thank you, but I'm not a native speaker, actually. Gracias, pero en realidad no soy un hablante nativo. Thank you, but I'm not a native speaker, actually. Tell me your secrets.
Puedo memorizar alrededor de 50 palabras nuevas en español al día.
I can memorize around 50 new Spanish words a day. Puedo memorizar alrededor de 50 palabras nuevas en español al día. I can memorize around 50 new Spanish words a day. Wow, it's important to be constant. Yeah, just be sure to revise like the words you have studied before so you don't forget.
Puedo ver películas en español sin subtítulos.
I can watch Spanish movies without subtitles. Puedo ver películas en español sin subtítulos. I can watch Spanish movies without subtitles. I still use subtitles for English. Sé cómo conjugar todos los verbos irregulares. I know how to conjugate all the irregular verbs. Sé cómo conjugar todos los verbos irregulares. I know how to conjugate all the irregular verbs. Yeah, there are a lot of them, so that would be great if you knew how to did all of them right. There might even be Spanish people who cannot do that properly in some cases, so. This is the end of today's 10 phrases to amaze native speakers. So I hope you get the chance to use them. Thank you for watching. Don't forget to subscribe. Bye. Yeah, I can. Teach me.
Hello everybody, Rosa here. Welcome to As a Teacher, where I'll answer some of your most common Spanish questions. The question for this lesson is, how can you tell if a noun is masculine or feminine? In Spanish, every noun has a gender. That applies to plural nouns too. Other Romance languages have masculine and feminine nouns too. It's a trait that comes from Latin, and the gender can depend on its origin in an older Latin word. English doesn't have masculine or feminine nouns, so the easiest way to tell the gender of a noun is to take a look at the last letter of a noun. The general rule is that if a noun ends in A, it is feminine. For example, la manzana, the apple, la ventana, the window, and la casa, the house. Nouns that end in O are generally masculine. For example, el horno, the oven, el perro, the dog, and el libro, the book. The only thing is, there are a lot of exceptions. For example, el mapa, which is the map, even though it ends in A, it is masculine. And el día, meaning the day, which is also masculine. Some other examples are la foto, meaning the photo, which is feminine even though it ends in an O, and la mano, the hand, which is also feminine. Because there are so many exceptions, it's best to learn the nouns with their articles. These are di and a in English. For Spanish, it would be el or un in for masculine words, and la or una for feminine words. However, O and A are not the only indicators for masculine and feminine words. Here are a few others. Nouns that end in I, ma, or an accented vowel such as I are often masculine. For example, el perfume, the perfume, el programa, the program, el colibrí, the hummingbird, are all masculine. On the other hand, nouns that end in D, Z, or ion are normally feminine. For example, la felicidad, the happiness, la nariz, the nose, and la religión, the religion, are feminine. It's important to remember what gender a noun is because it sometimes influences other parts of the sentence they modify. Adjectives in particular change their spelling according to the gender of the nouns they modify. It goes a bit like this. A notebook, un cuaderno, is masculine. So to say a red notebook, you could say un cuaderno rojo. An apple, una manzana, is feminine. So a red apple could be una manzana roja, with rojo changing to roja, ending with an A. I hope that answers the questions. If you have any more questions, please leave them in the comments below and I'll try to answer them. Hasta luego!
When learning a new language, it's easy to think, I don't think I'm making any progress. What if I never reach my goals? We all get these thoughts from time to time, but are they worth being scared of? What are the fears language learners tend to have the most? And how can you learn to overcome them? Here are the top four language learning fears, according to our users. Number one, I'm not good enough to start speaking yet. This is a pretty common fear or misconception that most learners have. Here's how you overcome it. The best way to get good at speaking is to start speaking from day one. You need to open your mouth and just start talking. If you think you're not good enough, just focus on the lines you want to say. Number two, I'm afraid I'll never be fluent. You've got to set small, specific goals. Make daily goals, like having just a 5-minute conversation. As these small goals add up, you'll be speaking more comfortably. Number three, I'm not making any progress. There are two things you can do right now. Use the dashboard to track your progress. Our dashboard shows how much you've accomplished. Or try a harder lesson on our website. The lessons come with line-by-line translations, and the hosts explain everything. Now you can understand something you didn't minutes ago. Number four, I'm afraid of not understanding anything I hear. This fear can occur when you hear advanced grammar and vocabulary and it just goes completely over your head. To beat this, simply read along with our line-by-line tool. It's the best way to instantly understand advanced conversations. Translations and scripts are right in front of you. For real-life situations, learn useful phrases such as, "Can you say it more slowly?" "I don't understand." There's nothing wrong with saying that you didn't understand something. So, these are the top four fears and how to overcome them. Luckily, we also have the perfect tools available to help you conquer your fears. Sign up for your free lifetime account. No credit card required, and you'll get the best free online resources. Don't let your fears stop you. Start learning now.
Hi everybody, I'm Rosa. Welcome to As a Teacher, where I'll answer some of your most common Spanish questions. The question for this lesson is, What are the main differences between Spanish from Spain, Latin America, and the Caribbean? Spanish is one of the world's most widely spoken languages. It's the official language in 19 countries as well as in Puerto Rico. It's so widespread because of Spanish colonial history. During the colonial period, Spanish mixed with native regional languages, and that's why Spanish is so different around the world. There's no standard Spanish dialect, only regional dialects. So it's common for Spanish learners to run into different kinds of Spanish, especially in terms of pronunciation. In the US, Latin American Spanish is what's most commonly taught in schools. It's spoken in most of Central America and South America, including Mexico, and excluding Argentina, Brazil, Suriname, French Guiana, and Guyana. Latin American Spanish has strong R's and a relatively clean pronunciation. Words are pronounced mostly as they are written. Here are just a few regional varieties of Latin American Spanish. Caribbean Spanish often drops S's at the end of the words, making it sound a lot faster than Spanish from other countries. Mexican Spanish take a lot of vocabulary from the indigenous language Nahuatl. You may be familiar with the word chocolate, which comes from the word chocolat in Nahuatl. Also, the double L in Mexico has a Y sound, so my name is Ricardo, is me llamo Ricardo. Colombian Ecuadorian Spanish is a mixture of Caribbean Spanish and Coastal Spanish. Here the double L usually sounds like a J, me llamo Ricardo. Argentinian Spanish is in a category by itself. It's very different from the Spanish spoken in the rest of Latin American countries. It has some indigenous Guarani vocabulary, but also French and Italian immigrants strongly influenced this dialect. An interesting fact about Argentinian Spanish is that Argentinian slang, called lunfardo, was originally a made-up prison language. Prisoners, mostly Italian, used it so guards couldn't understand what they were saying. Now, lunfardo words are used all over Argentina. Argentinian Spanish also uses vos, the formal you address, instead of tú, the more common informal address in Latin America. The double L is pronounced like a J or ZH, like in me llamo Ricardo. Spanish in Spain is called Castilian Spanish. Some pronunciations are very different than the other kinds of Spanish we've already mentioned. The double L is pronounced differently depending on the region within Spain. The Latin American CC is pronounced with a TH and sound like thi, th. For example, gracias, meaning thank you, is pronounced gracias in Latin American Spanish and gracias in Castilian Spanish. Another major difference is that Castilian Spanish often uses the plural form vosotros instead of the form ustedes, which is used in Latin America. Pretty fascinating, isn't it? If you have any other questions, leave a comment and I'll try to answer them. Ciao!
Want to speak real Spanish from your first lesson? Sign up for your free lifetime account at SpanishPod101.com.
Hello, this is Rosa. Welcome to Spanish Top Words. Today we'll be doing must-know expressions for agreeing and disagreeing. ¿Puedo añadir algo aquí? Can I add something here? ¿Puedo añadir algo aquí? Can I add something here? So it's a polite way to interrupt someone who's talking. ¿Qué opinas? What do you think? ¿Qué opinas? What do you think? Always nice to ask for others' opinions. Así es exactamente como me siento. That's exactly how I feel. Así es exactamente como me siento. That's exactly how I feel. Yeah, nice expression to agree with someone when you're having like a deeper conversation, I would say. Eso es cierto. That's true. Eso es cierto. That's true. You're learning Spanish. That's true. Es cierto. No estoy de acuerdo. No. I don't agree. No. No estoy de acuerdo. No. I don't agree. No. One time is not enough. You have to, like, repeat it at the end. No hay duda de eso. No doubt about it. No hay duda de eso. No doubt about it. So if someone would tell me, like, oatmeal is an awesome breakfast food, I could say, no doubt about it. No hay duda de eso. No podría estar más de acuerdo contigo. I couldn't agree with you more. No podría estar más de acuerdo contigo. I couldn't agree with you more. Sushi is the best food ever. I couldn't agree with you more. No podría estar más de acuerdo contigo. Sí, tienes razón. Yes, you're right. Sí, tienes razón. Yes, you're right. SpanishPod101.com is the best way to learn Spanish. Yes, you're right. Vamos a seguir adelante, ¿vale? Let's just move on, shall we? Vamos a seguir adelante, ¿vale? Let's just move on, shall we? If some discussion is getting a little bit too heated at some point, you just can say that and try to move on to another topic.
Exactamente. Exactly.
Exactamente. Exactly. He should take better care of his health. Exactly. Exactamente. And this is the end. Today we did más no expressions for agreeing and disagreeing. I hope you liked them. Tell us which one was your favorite. Please don't forget to check out SpanishPod101.com and please subscribe to this channel. Bye! Hasta pronto!
Hi everybody, Rosa here. Welcome to Ask a Teacher, where I'll answer some of your most common Spanish questions. The question for this lesson is, how do you know when to use ser o estar? This can be confusing for Spanish learners, especially for native English speakers, because both ser and estar mean to be. First, let's go over the forms of ser. I am, yo soy, you are, singular, tú eres. He, she, is, you are, polite. Él, ella, usted, es. We are, nosotros somos, you are, plural. Vosotros sois. They are, you are, polite and plural, ellos, ellas, ustedes, son. The different form of estar are yo estoy for I am, tú estás for you are, singular, él, ella, usted está for he, she is, you are, polite, nosotros estamos for we are, vosotros estáis for you are in polite form, and ellos, ellas, ustedes están for they are. You are, polite and plural. There is a subtle but simple difference between the two words for to be. Estar is for temporary conditions such as feelings and emotions, and that's why how are you is como estás. Ser is for characteristics or permanent states of being. For example, if I'd say I am American, I would say yo soy americano. Here's a good rule of thumb. Turn the sentence into a question. If the question uses how, then use estar. And if it uses what, use ser. Take the word callado, for example, which means quiet. Depending on which verb you use, the nuance will be different. If you say ella es callada, which uses ser, that means she's quiet, as in she's a quiet person. On the other hand, if you say ella está callada, which uses the verb estar, that would mean she's being quiet. The nuance is that this situation is temporary and that she's just being quiet in this moment in time. Pretty cool, right? If you have any more questions, please leave a comment and I'll try to answer them. Bye!